Good morning.
Welcome to Maranatha Baptist Church. It's nice to see all of you. Well, Pastor's going to come and open us up in a word of prayer. And if men and boys would like to come join me at the altar, why don't you go ahead and do that right now.
And don't forget, if you're visiting with us today and you want to get one of those visitor's packets there, if you hadn't got one there on the Welcome Center there, make sure you fill out the card there so we have a record of your attendance. Let's bow for prayer. Father, thank you so much for what you've done for us. And Lord, we ask that today you'd feel welcome in our service. God, forgive us of our sins and cleanse our hearts. Help us, Lord, to hear from you today in a powerful way. Help us to hear things, Lord, that will change our lives and make us better people. God, I pray for each man, woman, and child that's in here today, God, that you would do something in their hearts as special. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. All right, grab your songbooks, and we are going to sing Crown Him with Many Crowns, song number 13. So let's stand to our feet, song number 13. Brother Steve's going to come and lead us. Crown Him with Many Crowns.
Crown Him with many crowns, the Lamb upon His throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem drowns all music but its own. Awake my soul and sing of Him who died for thee, and hail Him as thy matchless King through all eternity. Crown Him the Son of God before the worlds began, and ye who tread where He had trod, crown Him the Son of Man. Who every grief hath known that wrings the human breast, and takes and hears them for His own, that all in Him may rest. Crown Him the Lord of life, who triumphed o'er the grave, who rose victorious to the strife for those He came to save. His glories now we sing, who died and rose on high, who died eternal life to bring, and lives that death may die. On the last, crown Him the Lord of heaven, one with the Father known, one with the Spirit through Him given, from yonder glorious throne. To Thee be endless praise, for Thou for us hast died. Be Thou, O Lord, through endless days adored and magnified.
Amen. I love the words of that song. Please remain standing, grab your Bibles, and we are in Psalm 149 this morning.
Amen. Psalm 149. Let's read aloud together. Beginning with verse 1. Praise ye the Lord. Sing unto the Lord a new song, and His praise in the congregation of saints. Let Israel rejoice in Him that made him. Let the children of Zion be joyful in their King. Let them praise His name in the dance. Let them sing praises unto Him with the timbrel and harp. For the Lord taketh pleasure in His people. He will beautify the meek with salvation. Let the saints be joyful in glory. Let them sing aloud upon their beds. Let the high praises of God be in their mouth, and a two-edged sword in their hand, to execute vengeance upon the heathen and punishments upon the people,
to bind their kings with chains and their nobles with fetters of iron, to execute upon them the judgment written. This honor have all his saints. Praise ye, Lord. Isn't that an interesting verse? This honor, executing judgment, the judgment that's written upon people who have, on the heathen, upon the wicked. It says, this honor have all his saints. We were talking about it in Sunday school class this morning. The honor is to rule at some point. It's something to think about, isn't it? Something to ponder. All right, you may be seated. We're going to take up our offering at this time. Brother Steve, why don't you come and lead us in our offering?
All right, ushers, if you would come forward then, please, for the offering. We are going to take our customary three offerings this morning. If you're visiting with us, please do not feel obligated to give anything. If you don't want to, that's strictly between you and God. But the first offering is our general fund offering. Second is our missions offering. And the third is a change offering that our children will take up with cups for the Crisis Pregnancy Center. All right, let's pray for the offering. Heavenly Father, thank you for the privilege to give. Lord, I ask that you'd bless each giver. I pray that you'd bless each person here this morning that can't give. And Lord, I ask that you would watch over those that couldn't be here this morning. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
righty. So, everybody excited about school being about done?
Yeah.
Hmm? You got summer plans? Yeah? What's your summer plans? You going to go fishing? You're going on a vacation, you hope so?
We're going to Orange Beach, Alabama.
You're going to Alabama. That's a good thing. Gonna go listen to Alabama in Alabama? Gonna see Alabama, listen to Alabama, and go to Alabama?
No.
No. Silly. I'm just trying to get Zach to talk. All right. Well, let's pray, okay? Father, thank you for these young people that have given themselves this morning or serving here in the church. I pray that you bless them, Lord, and as we ask every week, that you'd help them to grow up their whole lives to serve you. God, help them to see the value in it. Help their parents and teachers to guide them correctly. I pray that you take this offering that they collected, and I pray that you'd use it for the needs of these people that come to the Crisis Pregnancy Center. And we'll thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. We'll see you guys.
As far as announcements go, the 18th of May is the next Soaring Eagles Fellowship. It's here at the church. They said that it's going to be a baseball theme, so wear your favorite jersey or hat. You know, you got to represent. Bring your running shoes, they said, because you're going to play. No, just kidding. They're going to play some kind of baseball trivia game. No running bases included, though. So there will be a sign-up sheet in the foyer. Maybe there is one now. I'm sorry, I didn't notice. So please sign up for that. You'll be grilling hot dogs outside, and that sounds good. Anything with a baseball theme sounds awesome to me. Okay, one more announcement. Around the church here, we have a few things we'd like to get done this spring outside, and so I'm going to be trying to organize a work day or two or three, this Saturday being the first one. Weather permitting, I have 7 different projects we'd like to get done around the outside. So if you can prune, if you can spread mulch, if you have a chainsaw and like to play with it, if you can paint, I could use you. I could use probably a dozen different people among the different projects. If Saturday doesn't work and you have a free evening or an afternoon, I'll take whatever I can get. So please let me know if you can help. And then I will tell you what I have. You can tell me what you can do. And then we'll see what kind of tools we can come up with. So that, I believe, is all the announcements we have. So why don't we stand one more time, turn to 349. 349, and we're going to sing A New Name in Glory. 349.
I was once a sinner, but I came pardon to receive from my Lord. This was freely given, and I found that he always kept his word. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. And the white-robed angels sing the story. A sinner has come home, for there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven, never more to roam. I was humbly kneeling at the cross, fearing not but God's angry frown. When the heavens opened and I saw that my name was written down, there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. And the white-robed angels sing the story. A sinner has come home, for there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine.
With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven, never more to roam. In the book 'tis written, saved by grace, oh, the joy that came to my soul. Now I am forgiven, and I know by the blood I am made whole. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. And the white-robed angels sing the story, a sinner has come home. For there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven, never more to roam. Amen. You can be seated.
Amen. We'll dismiss the kids to the junior church class at this time. The rest of you, if you'd open your Bibles to 1 Peter chapter 4 and Galatians 6. We're going to go to 1 Peter 4, and then we're going to jump over to the book of Galatians, Galatians number 6. 1 Peter 4 verse 10 says this, "As every man hath received the gift, even so minister the same one to another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God." Good stewards of the manifold grace of God. A steward is somebody who is given a responsibility, and that responsibility, they are supposed to take care of something. The grace of God is given to you, and you are supposed to take care of that grace. You are a steward of the grace and mercy of God. Now I want you to hear this. The message I want to talk to you about this morning, we're going to flip over to Galatians 6 now. What I want to preach to you about for a little bit is that you are the responsible party when it comes to stewarding the grace of God. You are the responsible party. Oftentimes when I was a boy, I would be running out of the house. Mom was, I had five sisters, and they were all older than me. The next sister above me is 3 years older than me. My other sisters were engaged in a Christian school and so on, involved in that. And they were always off going somewhere or dating some guy or something. You know, it was always gone. It seemed like I was always tearing through the house. I have these images of running through the house, running to a tree, going to climb a tree, going to do something. Always a busy kid. I remember when my mom would say to me, as I would just go out the door, she would say, "Behave yourself." And I always remember turning, looking at her and saying, "I always behave myself." And we had this thing, she'd turn and she'd look at me and she said, "Are you going to behave me when I'm not there?" And a lot of the things that we would do, I remember things when we would camp out. We did a lot of camping out. A bunch of us boys did. We had a little woods out behind our house and a lot of woods around our area. And we had a creek running near us, and we'd like to hunt crawdaddies and frogs and fry frog legs over the campfire and that kind of stuff. It was a lot of fun. And I remember different projects we would do when there were not adults around. You know, for example, playing tag on the barn beams. We had this one big barn, and it had beams. I mean, they were this wide. I mean, they were perfectly safe, that wide. And the only thing in the barn, I mean, there was a corn crib. There was a lot of raccoons. We had goats in that barn. And we had, random pieces of cars and things that were being worked on. But we go up at night, and remember, we'd camp out, we'd go up and we'd turn on the lights in the barn, and we'd chase each other on the beams. Basically, the problem was there was no responsible party. when you're a bunch of kids get together, and there's no adult there, it's like things happen that just prove science, that your prefrontal cortex does not work when you're a kid. I mean,
standing on a bike seat, trying to balance, going down the road. We did that quite a bit. We tried. I didn't say we did it. We tried. All kinds of things. We made zip guns that would fire shotgun shells. Yeah, out of little pipes. All kinds of stupid things that you can get in trouble with when you're living in the country. Nobody's really watching. No responsible party. Here's the thing. Whenever there was a gathering like that, usually somebody was supposed to be in charge. In fact, when we do something at the church, the teens would get together or something, there was always supposed to be someone there who was in charge. Because when there wasn't, tomfoolery happened. It wasn't really a good idea when the one in charge was as immature as the ones that were in the charge, but it happened. You guys know what I'm talking about. You've heard that. There needs to be a responsible party, right? How many of you have ever told your kids that when they're going somewhere? Needs to be a responsible party. Now, here's the thing. I want you to understand about the grace and mercy of God that don't look around for someone else to be the responsible party. You are the one. You've been given gifts. You've been given an opportunity. You've been given grace. And it's time for you to grow up and be the responsible party. I want to tell you one of the problems we have in our culture today is that people do not take responsibility for themselves. That's what I want to talk to you about. I got four things I want to say to you. We're going to go to Galatians chapter 6, and Galatians 6 outlines four things here that God tells us we are responsible for. And I want to look at those things one at a time briefly. Galatians chapter 6, verse 1 says, "Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such an one in the spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted. Bear ye one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ." I want to say to you that whenever I've seen this happen, it's like a breath of the Spirit of God that'll sweep through a church. It is amazing to see. But I want to tell you that 99% of the time, this does not happen in a church. Bear ye one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. What's he talking about here? If you see someone overtaken in a fault, what should you do? Let me ask you a quick question here. How many of you know somebody, when I say the phrase, when you see a brother overtaken in a fault, brother or sister, when that phrase comes across your mind, immediately somebody's face appears in your mind. You can think of someone. That's, how many of you, raise your hand if you can think of someone. Okay. So, is this person that you're thinking of, is it another Christian, another person, another, somebody in the body of Christ? You say, somebody, I'm not going to ask you if they're in this room, okay? But let's say there's immediately somebody comes to mind that you know of that's overtaken in a fault. Here's what usually happens when we see somebody overtaken in a fault. First of all, we are frustrated with them. Because we know when that person's overtaken in a fault, we know that they shouldn't be that way. They shouldn't act that way. They're grown up. They're old enough. They ought to do better than that. But, and so immediately we have a frustration. Now, what's interesting, what happens next usually is we find someone else who will share our frustration. And if they haven't even thought about it, we give them our frustration. We kind of dump on them. That helps us and makes us feel better. It's what we call debriefing. We're traumatized by somebody else who has overtaken in a fault. It's bothered us a lot. They shouldn't be that way. And so we've got to talk to somebody about it. So we find somebody else and we share with them our burden and our thought. And they're like, if they've never thought about it before, they're like, yeah, that makes sense. And suddenly now we have two people that see this brother overtaken in a fault and we're all concerned. Now, if we're doing this spiritually, what we'll do is we'll call them or we'll talk to them on Facebook or private message them or something, or talk to them privately and say, this brother or sister that's overtaken in a fault, let's pray about it. We need to pray for this person. If we're spiritual, that's what we do. Really not intending to pray about it at all, not really interested in bringing him before the Lord, we just feel frustrated and want to dump it on somebody. That's usually the MO that I've witnessed in the church. Folks, you are responsible. If you see a brother or sister overtaken in a fault, they stumble and fall, it is your job to make sure to do everything in your power to get them back on the right track. That does not necessarily mean get in their face and tell them something. That means, first of all, you do get on your face before God and you plead with God to help them. Here's what happens a lot of times. At least this is my experience. Every time I get on my face before the Lord and I start praying and asking God to help a brother that's overtaken in a fault, it always seems to me that God reminds me of some beam or another that's in my own eye that I need to fix. And so I'm usually just, okay, let's table that. We'll come back to it later. God, can you fix them anyway? Because usually the fault that we see in somebody else is really quite a bit smaller than the one we have ourselves that we're dealing with. And that could be why we're not as responsible as we should be. Everybody's quiet. Is that an oh me or an amen? You see, what I'm saying is, you are the responsible party. You're responsible for a brother or sister in Christ that stumbles and falls and is struggling in some particular area. You are responsible. Well, maybe the preacher will straighten them out. Guess again. Can't even get them to sit down long enough to listen to me. Maybe they won't listen to you either. But do you care enough to do your best to restore them? Some of you do. I know. Look at people that you haven't seen in a while in church. Or maybe there's somebody in church and they just got an attitude that swings both directions. You never know what's going to happen. Woo! And they say, one guy said he would, when he went home, he'd throw his shoe in to the kitchen before he went through the door. He said just to see what kind of mood his wife was in. If the shoe came out, he knew he needed to stay back in the garage for a while. The shoe came back out at him. Sometimes people are that way, and you're like, wow, here's somebody. You never know what mood they're going to be in. Boy, they're over here. They're really happy and wonderful and full of God. And then over here, they're like full of dark clouds and Eeyores traveling right with them. In fact, they're giving him inspiration. It's like, wow, you don't know what you got here. And, well, let's just leave that person alone. We're going to walk over here, and we're going to leave them alone. Why pass by on the other side? Hey, where's the good Samaritan in you? Maybe they're bruised. Maybe they're hurting. You know what? I've found this out. Somebody said it one time, and I found it to be true. Hurt people hurt people. If someone's hurting, their usual reaction is to lash out and hurt other people, like a wounded bear. If someone in the church has just got a bad attitude and they're hurting everybody, 9 times out of 10, it's a problem they're dealing with that they're dealing with by themselves, and they need some help. There are some exceptions. My dad was pastoring in Northwest Iowa. Little town up there. My sister was just telling me a week ago or so about reminding me about this lady. Her name was Maggie. I grew up hearing about Maggie, and Maggie was a piece of work. It was a little church, and the guy that left the church and left it for my dad to come and pastor, he said, listen, I'm going to tell you something. It doesn't matter what you preach. Doesn't matter what you do. He said, you'll be here a long time if you get along with Maggie. If you don't get along with Maggie, forget it. Well, the problem was my dad was just not one of those getting along with whatever's going on kind of guys. And so he'd see somebody with a little attitude. In fact, the thing, if you wanted to get my dad preaching really hot, make a face at him in church while he's preaching. Or act like you're not paying attention. Buddy, you're going to be there an hour longer. And it's going to get hot and it's going to get a little fun. I've seen that happen a few times. And Maggie was just, she was a problem. So Dad got up and preached something she didn't like. The next service, she came and plopped herself right in the front row. And she put her fingers in her ears while he was preaching and did this. I'm lying, I'm dying. That's what she did. You're like, are you, Dad stopped and looked at her. Are you serious right now? Well, that just was like sick him to a hound dog. And he got really hot and started getting really mad. Well, he didn't last in the church very long. But I will tell you this. Maggie got cancer of the throat and died just a very, very, very small shadow of herself. Because she did nothing but contradict and go against everything that was ever preached in the pulpit. Constantly. So I'm going to tell you, a person like that, I mean, it's like sometimes you might as well just leave them alone. Okay? But I'm going to tell you, most people in the church that are hurting other folks, you know, they're hurting other people because they're hurt themselves. And you are responsible for that. Do this. Just checking to see if you're getting this. I wonder if that person you thought about, or the person that came to mind just now or a little bit ago, I wonder if that person is somebody you'd be willing to help bear their burdens. I wonder if it's someone that you could say, look, I want to be careful, but I'd like to help them. He says, consider thyself lest thou also be tempted. What happens is, sometimes a person like that will have a truckload of stuff they need to dump on somebody. So if they dump it on you, are you strong enough to handle it? Or are you going to get swept into the same problem they've got? You got to be careful with that. That's what he says. Consider thyself, lest thou also be tempted. Sometimes a murmur and a gossip is just somebody that's got a whole lot of stuff inside, a whole lot of frustration, and they just need to pop the cork and need to talk to somebody about it. Are you strong enough to handle that? Or will you buy into their story? Will you look past the stuff, the garbage, and help a person in need? Will you do that? You're the responsible party. Secondly, I want to show you something else here. Verse 4 and 5 says, let every man prove his own work, and then shall he have rejoicing in himself alone and not in another. For every man shall bear his own burden. You're responsible for your own life. Do you know, you are the responsible party. I used to tell my kids as they were growing up, every man's responsible for his own garbage. You carry out your own trash. I almost preached a whole sermon on that this morning. The Lord directed me to cover some other things as well. But, you know, 1 Timothy 5, verse 4 says, piety begins at home. You have some things at your house that need to be taken care of. Your home. You're responsible for them. No one else is. Culture we live in is a blame culture. You guys have heard the phrase snowflakes. You've heard about that. You know. Basically, the problem with this whole snowflake mentality, a lot of folks, the older folks, are saying it's all young people, millennials, whatever else. And you forget that the millennials are now 30s and 40s, or 30s anyways, late 20s and 30s. That's the millennials. They're growing up now, and I keep forgetting that. But we point the fingers at millennials, and we say, well, they're a bunch of snowflakes and whatever, and that's a bad thing to do. I know a lot of young people that are not snowflakes. In fact, I know a lot of young people that are doing something for God, and I'm excited to see them see them move forward and do some amazing things. And I'm really, my hat's off to the young people of this generation that are getting it right. There are a bunch that are. But the snowflake part of our society, and you cannot deny that there is a group of our, there is a part of our population, there's something wrong with the way they think. If President Trump causes you to have a meltdown and want to commit suicide when you've never even met the man, you've never met him, you've never been in his house, you've never seen him, you don't really know anything about him but what somebody tells you. How did you let him get that far into your life? Same with President Obama when he was the president. How do we let these people get so far into our lives? If folks, your life is the sum total of your choices. You say, well, I came from a broken home. So did 50% of the population. Well, I've seen some horrible things. So has everyone. Job said, man that is born of woman is few days and full of trouble. Man is born to trouble as the sparks fly upward. I can tell you, I mean, you say, well, wow, I'm homeless. I've been homeless before. I mean, name something. Pick something. Everybody, I mean, there's a lot of people that are dealing with it. Whatever you're, that's causing you a meltdown. Stop blaming everybody else for the place you're in your life. So, well, I just didn't, when my ship came in, I was at the airport. Well, okay, I understand. Maybe somebody didn't dump $1 million on you, and maybe you bought too many lottery tickets and never got any money off of them. Okay, stop buying lottery tickets. Okay, use that money for food instead of paper. I mean, okay, that might work. And did I tell you guys how much lottery money is spent in Mattoon in 1 month's time? I saw the specs on it. Something like $6 million in gambling in Mattoon in 1 month. This was a month of May, was what I was looking at 2 years ago. $6 million in gambling. And you know what? If you were to look at those people, most of them did not have the money to spend on the game. They were trying to put some money in so they could get some money back so they could, you know, win big or whatever and have some big thing that they had in their mind. They're going to pay off the double wide or something. I don't know. What, you know. So, well, I don't have any money. Why don't you sit down with a piece of paper and think about how much money you spend and figure out where it all goes? If I told you, I've been in some places where the average monthly salary is what teenagers in our town get an hour. So I know it costs more to live here. I understand you got to pay for Netflix and Hulu, and I get it. And their cell phone, and you got to be able to get on Facebook anywhere at any time. And so you got to have the biggest package. You got to have unlimited data. These are things we got to have. I mean, got to have Fox. Come on, Fox News. Good gracious. I decided I was going to trim my entertainment package back a little bit. And so I called up Consolidated and I said, give me just the basic TV thing. I want to take everything off. And the next day I turned the television on. I couldn't get Fox News. And I called them and said, put it right back on. So much for so much for me saving money. Wow. We got to have all this stuff. I mean, I'm just as bad as the next guy. I mean, think about it. All the stuff we spend on cars and so got to have a car. You don't really. Yes, you do in this day and age. You know, there are people that live in cardboard boxes in our world. I know you don't need to, okay? I'm not telling you go out and live in a cardboard box. I'm not trying to make you feel guilty for what you have. My point is simply this. You spend everything that you make and then some. And if you got more money, you'd spend all that and then some. That's the way we are. Henry David Thoreau, in his book Walden Pond, he explored that philosophical viewpoint. He decided to get rid of everything and go out and live by this pond. And he wrote the book on the issue. What he did, he concluded that everyone will always spend more than they make. He said that's our natural bend. We always want to spend up. And then when we get a little more money, we don't stay at the same class. We step ourselves up into the next class. And then we get a little more money, and we step ourselves up into the next class. It always amazed me how billionaires could just, you know, do what they will go look in their houses. Their houses are bigger. Their garages are bigger. They have more outgo. Some years ago, a lady in Detroit won the lottery. She got like several million dollars. I don't know how much she got. And the problem is they found out she, what was it? She was still on the Link card or something. She was still getting Michigan financial aid. And she had several hundred million dollars or something. I don't know how much it was. And she said, well, you don't understand. When you have this kind of money, you have to pay for more things. No, you don't. No, you don't. She ended up going to jail or something for scamming the system. Why? Here's what I'm trying to say. Don't blame everyone else for your issues. Don't do that. Don't blame everyone else. One of the things I hear more than anything else when you're counseling with someone and they feel like they don't get you, they're having a problem and they're trying to explain it away and they're trying to get somebody else to take responsibility for the things that they did, they'll always say this. Watch this phrase. No one understands me. You're not understanding what I'm saying. Let me re-say it. You know, you can say it 10 different ways. You're still responsible for your life. I don't care how you say it. You are responsible. So if my husband did this, or if my wife did this, or wow, I wish my family was like, well, I wish we had those opportunities. No, no. Your life is the sum total of your decisions. You are responsible. Stop trying to blame everybody else for the things that are happening in your life. Listen to me, parents, teach your children this. When a kid, it's very simple. Teach them when they're little. When a teacher gives them an assignment, don't let them dump it on somebody else. Well, mom didn't give me the assignment. My wife says this in her class all the time. How old are you? The kids could probably laugh. They probably heard this over and over again. She used to say this to my kids. How old are you? You're old enough to accept responsibility for your own assignment tablet. Right? That's where you teach it. But mama didn't help me. Or my big brother, he left my books on the... Whose books are they? You take responsibility for your own stuff. Your own life. The teachers in here would say, yes, amen, write that, right? A bunch of you are teachers. You get what I'm saying? You hear, the dog ate it. Shoot the dog. No, not really. I'm just kidding. Third thing I want you to see is you're responsible for the ministry of God. You're a steward. Listen, here's what it says in Galatians 6. Let him that is taught in the word communicate unto him that teacheth in all good things. Listen to me. You young people, as you're getting jobs and you're making money, your job, your financial responsibility is the ministry of God as much as it is an older person. Look, I want to tell you, Tithing. Let's talk about tithing for a second. I don't teach Old Testament tithing. I don't teach that it's something you have to do. But I'm going to tell you this. That I read a gospel tract written by the Methodist Church back in 1800s. I found it in one of my great-grandma's Bibles. Okay? She had it. And this church figured out, they all of a sudden figured out that if they would use the biblical method of tithing, that the church never had a financial problem. Most churches that I pastor in, at one time or another, have financial difficulty. And most churches that I'm, not just what I pastor, but Brother Dale, you were a pastor. Brother Frederick, you were a pastor. You guys could admit to me that many times, one of your biggest frustrations is you don't have enough pennies to put together to do what has to be done. Right? That always happened. And boy, you sometimes when you're a pastor, you sit there and you're frustrated because if you had this amount of money, this could be done. Or this ministry could be done. Or something could be done better. And you're like, boy, I just don't have it. There's just no way to do this. No way to put the money together. Well, this Methodist church wrote this tract. They discovered that by everyone in the church giving 10% of their salary, they never had a financial problem. It's funny how that works. Well, another church picked it up, and another church picked it up, and it became a custom, and then the Baptist church found out about it, and boy, they started preaching it, and then when you became a Baptist, if you become a member, you had to become a tither, and then there's some other churches, some of these big ones. I saw another church in town building another big edifice, and probably a gym or something, and they started realizing that, boy, if our members, they need to pay. And so some of the churches start sending you bills. Has anybody ever got a bill, been a member of a church where you got a bill in the mail? Okay, there are some in our area that do that. They'll send you a bill, windowed envelope, you need to pay your tithe. There are some people, some churches, a fellow stopped in here the other day and he told me that a church that he had been in, when he became a member, had to tell them how much he made annually. And they put it on his bill to pay 10% to the church. I think that's all wrong. Don't do that. The Bible tells you you can give whatever you want to give. The New Testament, he said, give sparingly, you'll reap sparingly. Give bountifully, you'll reap bountifully. Give to the Lord. Do what you're supposed to do. But I want to tell you something. If we totaled up the salaries and the incomes that are in this room this morning, and we took 10% of that, the numbers on that board would blow your mind. You could just 10%. Everybody just giving 10%. It'll shock you. Look at this. Let's do something with missions. The other night we raised $110 for missions monthly, just like that. By young people saying, I'll give $10 a month. $10 a month, $120 is what we raised. $10 a month. $10, that's $2.50 a week, right? And with 10 people giving, no, with, was it five people? Five people giving $2.50 a week in the missions, we're able to take on another missionary. $2.50 a week divided by seven, you're between 30 and 40 cents a day. Right? So I don't know how many of you guys like coffee, but I do. If you go to Starbucks, some of you just don't. It's against your religion. God bless you. So I'm going to find something else that bothers you. But I'll find it. But bacon, and we're going to stay off of bacon because that's a spiritual thing. We're going to leave that alone. But the truth is, if you went to a coffee shop, I don't care if you want a coffee, if you went to the gas station, let's say on your way to work, and you're not going to pay $4 or a cup. And you just ain't no way. You're going to pay at least 50 cents to a dollar. Now, if you're a senior citizen and you drive through McDonald's and get the best coffee there is anyway, you can do that for 50 cents. And if you pretend you're a senior citizen and you drive through the drive-thru and they sell you a cup of coffee for 50 cents, still, and you do that every day, that's 50 cents a day. Again, your 50 cents a day by yourself, you think about it, you and four other people, your 50 cents a day would help another missionary get to the field. When you think about how insignificant your gift is, what you can, the kids that bring this change up here, do you know how many thousands of dollars we have given to the Crisis Pregnancy Center from quarters and nickels and dimes? Thousands of dollars that nobody even missed. I want to tell you something. Take your entertainment package, whatever it is, whatever you spend on entertainment every month. You say, well, I don't do anything. Oh, you do too. Everybody does something. You do what? I mean, if your entertainment is buying wrenches, that's still your entertainment. Okay? So maybe you don't do Facebook, but maybe you do Harbor Freight. Okay? God bless you. Okay, so what I'm saying is, whatever it is that you use your expendable cash on, you total that up some week. And then tell me you don't have any money to give to God. You see, the ministry, you have so much money expendable. In this culture, if you don't even get money, you can get a link card in our state. If you don't get money, you get a link card. You get extra food, and you can help people with that food. It's surprising what you can do. There is so much can be done with so little. And I want to say to you that it is your responsibility. Here's what I want you to think about this morning. When you get to heaven and you stand before the throne of God, you explain to Him how you didn't quite have enough money left over after you paid for all the things you wanted to pay for, including gas in your car to run around who knows where to do whatever you wanted to do. You tell God how that His ministry was hurting because you had too much. Or not enough time on your hands and not enough money. Here's what I want to show you something. Pay attention to this. I'm about ready to go into my fourth point, but I want you to get this. Read with me in Haggai. 2 Corinthians 9 says, "He that soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly." Here's what I want you to see. Look at what he says in Haggai. It's a minor prophet. He says in verse 3 of chapter 1, "Then came the word of the Lord." If you haven't found it, listen. Here, "Then came the word of the Lord by Haggai the prophet, saying, Is it time for you, O ye, to dwell in your sealed houses, and this house lie waste? Now therefore, thus saith the Lord of hosts, consider your ways." Here's what he's just asking you to consider it. "Ye have sown much and bring in little." So you're working hard. Working hard's not the problem. You're working hard, but you've brought in little. "You have not enough. You drink, but you're not filled with drink. You clothe you, but there is none warm. And he that earneth wages to put it into a bag with holes. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. Go up to the mountains and bring wood and build the house, and I will take pleasure in it." He's talking about the house of God. "And I will be glorified, saith the Lord. Ye looked for much, and lo, it came to little. And when ye brought it home," look what he says, "I did blow upon it." Why, saith the Lord of hosts? "Because of mine house that is waste, and ye run every man into his own house. Therefore, the heaven over you is stayed from dew, and the earth is stayed from her fruit. And I called for a drought upon the land, and upon the mountains, upon the corn, and upon the new wine, and upon the oil, and upon that which the ground bringeth forth, and upon men, and upon cattle, and upon all the labor of the hands." So look. You're wondering why you're working hard and don't have anything to show for it? He said, "Every time you bring it home, I just blow on it." Why? He said, "Because you're not taking care of your responsibility." He was telling the children of Israel they needed to build the house of God. Brings glory to God. Your church, the church building, I understand the temple of God is in the heart. I understand that. But your church building, does it bring glory to God? Where you worship? It does, doesn't it? It can. It should. That's your responsibility. You look around and you say, here people come in all the time. Well, preacher, that pile of dirt's been there. God showed it to you. Who's going to get the sticks in the yard? God showed it to you. Did you know there's been cobwebs hanging from the lights since? Why? God showed it to you. It's your responsibility. You know what? When you sit there, every time I sit and listen to a preacher, my eyes go all over the place, just like yours do when I'm trying to preach to you. And you know what bugs me? There's a piece of trim that's been missing up there for I don't know how long. Did God show it to anybody besides me? How many of you saw that? None of you? Not till I said it. Nobody saw that? Now, God was wanting me to point it out to you. That piece of trim bugs me. It's gone. Whose job is that? Whose job is it? God showed it to me. I'll get up there one of these days as soon as I get the guts to do it. You know what? There are things around this building that need to be done, need to be kept up. Whose job is that? Your church and how your church looks is your responsibility. Some of you guys get that. Some of you folks do that and understand that, and I appreciate it. I want you to know that. I'm not badgering you because we're at our last dime or whatever, but that's not, we're doing fine. We're paying our bills. But I want to tell you something. We could do so much more. We could. And 10%, that's not that much. You young people, when you think about giving to the Lord, here's what a lot of people do. So, well, I don't like the way the preacher's taking the church, so I'm not going to put my money in the offering plate. We'll show him who's in charge. Well, let me just ask you, who is in charge? Who are you giving to anyway? Who's in charge? Are you trying to say that you go to a church? You go to a church, you waste your time in a church that you think the preacher is God? That he thinks he's God? You really wasting your time? You're taking your family to a church that doesn't have it figured out that God's God, that God's in charge? And that you honestly think that the preacher's passing the plate every Sunday and that money is going to some personal private scheme he's got going on? Shame on you for sitting in a church that you think that's what's going on with the money. Shame on you, not shame on the preacher. It blows my mind that people will just throw money at a cultist. You listen, here's a preacher standing up there, and you know that money, he's skimming that money, he's scamming everybody. You say, well, I'll come and listen to him, but I'm not going to put my money in the plate. Why are you even listening? What are you doing spending your time there? Because somewhere in your heart, you know you're wrong. I want to tell you something. If you decide you're going to hold your money to control the preacher, here's what's going to happen to you. I want to tell you something. I don't think you should send money to Joyce Meyer. I don't think you should send money to Benny Hinn. But if you think you're sending it to God's ministry, you're sending it to God, frankly. If your heart is, I'm going to give this money to God and I want God to use it, if they blow it and they mess up with it, that's on them. Where's your heart in the whole thing? Do you understand? I'm not telling you to send money to any of those yahoos. But honestly, it's between you and God what you give. It is your responsibility. The ministry of the gospel of Jesus Christ is your responsibility. Let me wrap this up with one more thought. And that's found in verse 7 of Galatians 6. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. Whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. For he that soweth to his flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption, but he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting. Do you know here this is not talking about your environment, your circumstance, the church you're in, the city you're in, the place you're at? I'm dying. I'm not getting fed. Do you know what? When I'm hungry, I know where the cupboard is. If you lived in our house, you'd have that figured out. There are times where we have forage for yourself supper. It's like with our kids, you know, they come and go. They have different schedules, work schedules. We all have different schedules. And so we don't know. We can't always sit down at the same time. I mean, when your kids are young, you can do that. But when they get older and they all got different things going on, and it's like there ain't no way I'm going to stand up for an hour by the grill if nobody's going to eat it but me. It just isn't going to happen. We're going to find a microwave thing. You know? And so the cupboard's got food. The freezer's got food. And God bless you. Help yourself. You can cook. You're old enough to know how to turn the on button on the stove. You're old enough to do that. If you're hungry, eat. I remember when I was at teenager, my dad started having heart trouble. He was later, and 18, 19, something like that. And so my mom decided to start changing our diet to make a heart-healthy diet. And I'm going to tell you something. At that time, I was not interested in that. And so I was starving. I'd get up from my dinner of kelp and liver and get in my car and go to McDonald's, praise the Lord. In fact, I'll tell you the truth. Dad and I started riding bikes together for his health, and we rode to Dairy Queen. True story. If you're hungry, you know where the food is. Spiritually, you're responsible for your own spiritual health. You're responsible. You are the responsible party. I know you want to blame somebody else for your spiritual condition. That's easy. You want to blame the Christian school. Maybe not ours, but I've heard this so many times that I'm sick. I'm sick of it. Somebody called me the other day and said, "Preacher, I think we need to get rid of Christian schools." I said, "Why?" He said, "Look at the product." I said, You got a problem with me or something? I graduated from a Christian school. Is there a problem with this? I said to him, "Listen to me." I said, "Brother," I said, "my dad and I pastored together a period of 50 years at a church. And that 50 years, his ministry and my ministry overlapped. And we saw 50 people come out of the Christian school and go to full-time ministry. Do you know what? We saw some of them go to jail too. But that wasn't the Christian school's fault. There's pastors and missionaries all around the country that came out of our Christian school. It worked the way it was supposed to work. And there were jerks. There were idiots. There was one kid that was in our Christian school tried to sick his dog on my dad. My dad told him he was going to kill it with his bare hands, and that was another story. But there was some kid that tried to kidnap my sisters, and we shot at him with guns, and that's another story. They went to our Christian school. Some of them bugged my dad's office. One of them brought a .357 to school one day. There was some idiots. But I want to tell you something. It wasn't a Christian school's fault. So, "Oh, a preacher is too strict." Let me tell you something. You don't know strict. You don't know strict till you know the way I was raised. I was raised very, very strict. And you know what? All of my siblings are serving God. You know why? Because my dad believed what he preached and he practiced it. And we respected that. Strictness isn't the problem. You want to blame everything and everybody but your own stinking heart. "Well, I don't think I know. I'm not close enough to God. It's because of the way I was raised." No, no. You're not close enough to God because you didn't get close. Get under the glory, under the spout where the glory runs out. Don't stand there and watch somebody else get it all and say, It's not my fault. Yes, it is your fault. Isn't this an encouraging message today? The encouraging thing, my friends, is that because you are a responsible adult, the encouraging thing is that if you're not where you need to be, you're the one that can change that. You can change where you're at because you're responsible for it. And when you stand before the throne of God and you look up there and you say, it was the woman that thou gavest me. And she's going to say, it was the serpent. Boy, we get it honestly, don't we? God will bring it right back down to us. And He'll tell you, it's your responsibility. You will reap what you sow. You're the responsible party. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word today. Thank you for the challenge of it. Lord, I pray that we would be encouraged, Lord, to improve the situation and circumstances that are around us. Help us to be the light that we're supposed to be. God, forgive us where we start blaming everyone else. God, I'm sorry for ever doing that, ever accusing anyone of taking away my happiness or joy. God, I pray that you'd help us each to look inside and make the changes that we need to make. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Let's stand to our feet and we'll sing Amazing Grace together and we'll be dismissed. All right? Amazing grace, how sweet the sound.